My name is Dave Carson, I'm the campus president here at Baker College of Auburn Hills, and certainly I want to welcome all of our students, our faculty, our staff, and of course our visitors who are with us tonight for this very special evening. I certainly also want to thank, of course, the honorable judge, Richard Bernstein, of course, for joining us. We appreciate him taking his time out to come speak to us as well, so we look forward to his comments. Before we begin, I certainly want to take an opportunity on this November 11th to recognize those in the audience who have served in our armed forces or are currently serving. So if I could have those individuals please rise, if you are a veteran.
Judge. They looked at me bewildered and they said, well, what else could it be? And I responded by giving them the answer that everyone here today knows all too well. It's what makes you strong. It's your life experience. What makes this a great college, what makes you great students, is you come with incredible life experience. It is your life experience that defines you. It is your life experience that allows for you to appreciate and understand the world that we live in. It is your life experience that gives you a sense of purpose, a sense of mission, a sense of understanding. I remember awakening at Mount Sinai Hospital. This was after going through a catastrophic injury. I remember awakening in the trauma unit, where the pain was so severe. The prognosis was unknown. My future was uncertain. I came to realize the way that you all realize, that extraordinary things can, will, and must happen for each and every one of us. And the reason that I am so grateful to have the opportunity to be here with you tonight is because we connect. You are all incredible hard workers. You are all people who have not had it easy. You are all amazing students who have an incredible passion, an incredible understanding of the world that we live in. And you do what you do because you want things to become better. You want a better life for yourselves. You want a better life for your families. You want a better life for your community. You want to have an impact in the world. But you are driven by your experiences. You are driven by your understanding. You are driven by what you know and understand could be. I remember awakening. Coming to realize at that moment, as I laid in that trauma unit, that other than the choice that we as humans have, as it pertains to the great power struggle that exists amongst forces of good versus evil, that everything else that happens in our life, that everything else that happens to us, has been inscribed, has been set forth, has been etched into the great book of life. But the one great power that we as humans have is how do we choose to react to the lives that God has given each and every one of us? How do we choose to react to the faith that our Creator has bestowed upon us? What you have come to realize through your journey, through your experience, is that an easy life does not always correspond to a good one. Often it is the case that those who walk among us, like everyone here tonight, who have a challenge, a difficulty, a hardship, come to understand and appreciate what their purpose is, their mission, their reason for creation. So yes, our lives may not be easy, but they truly are fulfilling. I remember a call I got. I had just begun practicing law. It was a wonderful young mother. She called me and she wanted to know why it was that she could be a good person, she could be a kind person, that she could be a pious person, and she wanted to know why of all people in the world would God give her a child with special needs? What kind of a life was my baby going to have? She asked. Do you think he's ever going to have any friends? Will he ever live on his own and be independent? Do you think he'll ever get married and have family? Will there be anything about my child that will be remotely ordinary to that of other children? And at what point of our lives do you think we will ever have a chance to finally stop suffering? I remember answering her the same passion and energy and excitement that allows for me to connect with you. I remember telling her, from this point forward, there will be nothing about you or your family that will ever be ordinary again. Have to believe that you were sent here, that you were created to not be ordinary, but to be extraordinary. People like us, people like everyone here, don't ever suffer, but we do struggle. It's our struggle that makes us who we are. It's our struggle that gives us strength. It's our struggle that gives us guidance. The reason that you are so special, the reason I love being with you, is because you live, know, understand, and appreciate that struggle. It's that struggle that goes into your life experience. It's that life experience that makes each and every one of you extraordinary. That makes each and every one of you great. It's your life experience that is what's going to transform our community. It's going to impact our state. It's going to affect our nation, and it's going to change the world. See, it's through your life experience, it's through your challenges and struggle, that you come to have the greatest blessing that our Creator could ever bestow. You've been given the blessing of perspective, the blessing of understanding, compassion, connection, but most importantly, you've been given the incredible power to empathize, to understand, to relate, to connect. So just what is it that makes a good judge? It's that ability to treat people with respect, to treat people with dignity. It's not about publications, academics, intellectuals. It's about understanding challenge, about relating to difficulty, about appreciating hardship. It's about being able to relate and connect with the people that you serve. Judges need to become nicer. They need to become kinder. Not advocating that you change how they sentence or how they rule in the law. But when you go to court, you should be treated with dignity. You should be treated with respect. When you go to court and a judge says to you, "This is my courtroom," that judge should come to realize it's not their courtroom, it's the people's courtroom. He just works there as a servant to you. It is life experience that gives us humility. It is life experience that gives us guidance. It is life experience that makes us real. It is the life experience that you are going to bring forth that is absolutely essential. Essential for our society to grow and to become better. You know, it's interesting. When you're in the hospital as long as I was, you come to know the various nurses in your ward, and I remember they taught me a very valuable lesson. why I love being with you tonight is this is a lesson that you can appreciate better than most. It let me realize that people who are kind and good-natured and warm before they have a catastrophic accident become even nicer after it. They become even warmer after it. They become even more understanding after it. But those who haven't faced a lot of challenge or hardship or difficulty, something really significant happens, they simply don't know how to react. They don't know what to do. They don't know how they're going to move forward. They become angry and bitter. The real persona starts to shine through. Now, I have been blessed in my life. I've had the opportunity to complete 19 marathons. In addition, I've also had the opportunity of completing a full-scale Ironman competition. For those of you unfamiliar, an Ironman is a 2.4-mile swim, followed by a 112-mile bike, to be completed by a 26.2-mile run. The rules of the competition are quite simple. If you stop, if you rest, if you take a break, you run the risk of missing a cutoff. If a cutoff is missed, you will be immediately disqualified from the competition. If you finish at 12:01 and not 12 o'clock, it is simply like you were never even there. 2 years of work, effort, discipline, focus, training will simply be for naught. I want you to picture, if you would, how it would feel to dive into a frigid body of water. The water temperature that morning of the Coeur d'Alene Ironman was 55 degrees. I want you to envision how it would feel to swim in total darkness. You have absolutely no idea where you are. You have no idea where you're going. You have no idea what lies in front of you. You get kicked in the face over and over again by other competitors, and being blind, you can't brace for the ensuing impact. You try to surface, but it becomes impossible because there's other swimmers who are immediately above you. Lastly, other competitors become ensnared and entangled in the rope that connects you to your guide. As they become entangled, the rope starts to take you below the surface. You try to get oxygen. You try to get air. The more you struggle, the quicker the rope starts to take you below the surface. Every one of you either has or is going to experience this. You don't know what the future holds. You don't know what path to take. You're scared. You're in pain. It's a very difficult to realize that the body can be mortal, but our spirits are all powerful. Why is it that you can do everything right, that you can follow every rule, and yet it sometimes feels like you just can't get ahead? So just why is it that bad things happen to otherwise such good people? Just why is it that there are some who have to know a greater struggle or a greater hardship than others? Why do such things occur? Why do such things happen? What is the meaning of it? What is the purpose of it? What is the reason of it? It was a beautiful August morning. I was out walking in New York Central Park. At this point, I had completed 17 marathons and the Ironman. I could feel the warm sun, the beautiful beautiful morning. Now I've memorized Central Park. I've memorized the loop that encompasses the park. And after memorizing it, I feel comfortable walking in it independently. As I was walking, I was in the pedestrian lane. As I was in this lane, a bicyclist was traveling at over 35 miles an hour. The bicyclist was going at such a high rate of speed that he ultimately lost control of his bicycle. And in doing so, veered into the pedestrian lane where I was walking and struck me directly in the back. Injury was quite catastrophic. It required over 10 weeks of hospitalization at Mount Sinai in New York City. It's those little things that you miss the most. Not having the opportunity to go to the bathroom or take a shower. Having to lie in bed and not having that chance to reposition yourself without a nurse doing it for you every 10 to 15 minutes because you couldn't do it on your own. Those little things that make our life what it is. People used to come to visit me and I would ask them, so tell me, where are you going after this? They would apprise me that they're going to visit friends or go shopping or pick up their dry cleaning. And they would say it in a very rudimentary, mundane fashion. I remember thinking how much I would love to do those things. I remember thinking that that's really what life is about. That's what your journey is about. It's those little things that make life great. It's those little things that we strive for. It's those little things that help to keep us going. As you go through Baker, as you go through life, I would ask you to celebrate those small victories. Celebrate how far you have come. Do you have a journey in front of you? Most definitely. But tonight is our night to celebrate. Celebrate what you've accomplished. Celebrate what you've achieved. Celebrate where you are right now. Celebrate those victories that you should take a moment and realize are truly yours. It's those small victories that keep us going. Those victories like having a chance to sit up in bed. Those victories like having a chance to use a walker. Those victories like trying to find the way at the end of your room. Those victories that come when you can reach the nurse's station. It is those small victories that should never be taken for granted. It is those small victories that should be cherished and should be celebrated every day, every moment. It is those small victories that come to us that we don't recognize or realize their beauty, their incredible significance, and their truly profound meaning. It was about a year ago, and it was time for the New York City Marathon. Now this would be my 18th marathon, but it would be my first after a catastrophic injury. Running to the streets of New York with a shattered hip and a shattered pelvis would be difficult to say the least. It would be painful to say the least. But it's symbolic of your journey. It's symbolic of your life. As we ran through the streets of New York, athletics represents every phase. It represents the struggle. It represents the pain. It represents the peril. It also represents the incredible and enduring triumph. As we ran the streets of New York, and we reached mile 18, crossed the 59th Street Bridge, and started making our way up First Avenue, that yes, our bodies have limitations, that yes, our bodies are mortal, but we realize and we recognize the incredible power of our soul. We recognize the incredible power of our spirit. We recognize how the spirit can transcend, that the spirit can overpower. The spirit can guide us home. So why is it that bad things happen to otherwise such good people? And just why is it that there are some who walk among us that have to know a greater struggle or difficulty or hardship than others can possibly even imagine or attempt to understand? I think the answer is something that every one of you has come to and knows all too well. We reach a certain point in our lives where we simply can't focus our energy and our efforts on trying to get over it. Simply have no other choice but to just get on with it. For it is through the struggle and the challenge and the difficulty of life that we will do what is hard to achieve what is great. And I ask you tonight that we celebrate life. We celebrate who and where we are. We celebrate life the way that a great artist composes the most wondrous novel. And within this novel, there will always exist chapters. There will be chapters of pain, there will be chapters of setback, and there will be chapters of frustration. But as you know, it is only through those chapters that you can come to find hope, that you can come to find joy, and that each and every one of you will come to find nothing less than triumph. We are here tonight to celebrate the lives and the stories that we are writing, to celebrate it for the good and for the bad. We are here to celebrate as a college and as a community that basic idea that extraordinary things can, will, and must happen for us all. Most importantly, let us celebrate that most beautiful and transformative idea that yes, our bodies are mortal, but it is our spirits, that are true all powerful.
Blessing that comes with having a blind person in this position
Or let's take it a little further, is having a person who's different, who's just different from your traditional judge. It allows for a different perspective. It allows for a different understanding. It allows for a different appreciation to develop than what would already be there. That is what is so absolutely critical. And it's interesting because one of the big conversations is that what is the best way to choose judges? Is it better to do it through a nomination process where you have what they call a merit selection committee and let the committee decide? Or is it better to let the people decide? Is it better to allow for the people to have the opportunity to say who represents them? And what's interesting about my election was that what was fascinating about it was that I love this state. We live in a fantastic state. We live with incredible people. Michigan is just a wonderful state. Michigan has incredible, wonderful people, and it's my honor to have a chance to serve them. And you realize how good the people are throughout our state when you have a chance to travel around it, to go from city to city, town to town, and county to county. You realize just how good the people are in the state of Michigan. And it was interesting because people used to ask throughout the election, journalists, the people who were doing polls, they would ask people, you know, who are you voting for in this election? And people would say, well, I'm voting for Richard. When they asked them why are you voting for him? The response, I thought, was really quite beautiful. But I thought it was also very telling. People would say, you know, my daughter gets picked on every day at school. My son is going through a difficult time. I'm voting for Richard to be on the Supreme Court because I realize he's young. I realize he's different. I realize he's blind. But you know what? I feel that I can connect with him. I feel that he can connect with me. I feel that when he interprets the law, he will think about me. He'll think about my daughter. He'll think about my son. He'll think about how his decisions will truly impact the lives of the people of this great state. That's what being a good judge is really about. It's about having a connection. It's about more than just documents and briefs. Of course, those are critical. But what makes a good judge is that connection with people. What makes a good judge is understanding how the law truly intersects with the lives of the people, with the effect that you're having on people. You know, it's interesting. It's very easy as a judge to lose that connection. You wake up in the morning, I get into my car with my clerk, we drive from the parking garage of my building to the parking garage of the Hall of Justice in Lansing. We got a private elevator. We go up to a private floor to a private office. If you're not careful, you can start to lose that connectivity. You can start to lose that understanding. You can start to lose that compassion and that empathy. So when you ask the question, how do you make a difference as a judge? You make a difference as a judge by being there, by letting the other judges see how you work. When issues come up and discussions arise, when you have somebody with a different perspective, when you have somebody with a different understanding, when you have somebody with a different life experience, it requires others to look at things in a different way. It requires others to approach things in a different way. What happens when you deal with disabilities and people with special needs, it's quite interesting. It's not that people ever want to be mean. It's not that people ever really want to intentionally discriminate. They just don't think about a lot of issues. They don't think about a lot of things because they don't have to. So the incredible blessing that having a blind person in this position, that ultimately it changes how people look at things and how people view things. Just creates a newer appreciation, a better understanding, a way of thinking that otherwise wasn't there before. It just in last comment to this question, because it was a really good one. The reason that we have to celebrate, the reason that this is so exciting and so meaningful, is it wasn't a long time ago, maybe about 50 years ago, people with disabilities, people like myself, were sent away to institutions. The idea was that people who were different, people who didn't fit in, people with severe disability, should be living out of sight and out of mind. They should be away from society, away from people. Look at how far we've come. Look at what's been accomplished. Look at what's been achieved. Look at what we've been able to do. Look at what you're all a part of. Not only has the state of Michigan said that we don't want disabled people living away from us, we want disabled people representing us and representing us in our highest court. Other questions? Before you go into law school. So let me answer the question by first starting off by saying this. To all of you who are looking at going on to law school, and I hope that's many of you, and it's interesting because for those of you who say I want to go on to law school, you're always going to get met with this response. People are going to think that they're the first person to ever tell you this. They're going to say, oh, that's great. It's just what we need is another lawyer. Always a response you're going to get. Or just when we need more attorneys. Well, you know what? We need more lawyers. There's not enough lawyers. We need more attorneys. We need more lawyers that are willing to do civil rights. We need more lawyers that are willing to take on disability rights. We need more lawyers that are willing to take on challenging and difficult cases. We need more lawyers like you who have that life experience, who have that understanding of the world, who have that appreciation of the challenges and discrimination and difficulties that exist out there. We need more folks to go to law school for the reason of changing the world, for the reason of having an impact, for the reason of having an effect on the society that we live in. And what is remarkable about that is that they have to take the LSAT. And I can tell you unequivocally that the LSAT has absolutely no correlation to how you're going to perform in law school. It has no correlation to how you're going to perform as an attorney. I think the law school admissions test, quite candidly and quite possibly, has done the greatest damage to our civil rights, especially amongst the disabled, the way it's administered, the way it's created, the way that it's run, has had a horrible impact and effect on the civil rights of this nation. A, B, C, D, E, and F are seated at dinner party. If A is seated next to C, and B is next to D, and E is next to A, where is F in relation to C and B? Now this, of course, is a made-up question, but if you were to take the exam, it is going to tell you to diagram your answer in the space provided. Now, how does one do that if you're blind? How does one draw a picture? How does one do a diagram in the space provided if they are blind? How can we possibly require somebody who can't see to draw a picture or to do a diagram? It doesn't matter if you take the exam in Braille. It doesn't matter if you have 10 years to take it. It requires you to draw pictures and diagrams. Now, the sad reality of this is that there are so so many people with disabilities who want to go to law school because they want to do this work. And they are confronted with this exam that has no bearing upon their ability to practice law. That has no bearing on what kind of student they're going to be. But yet it does such tremendous harm and such tremendous damage to the people that we want in law school, to the people that we need in law school, to the people that we have in law school. This is a very long discussion topic, and it's a very long issue. And there are cases that are currently going on dealing with these issues, cases that I'm not able to get into, but there are cases that are currently happening that could have an impact and effect on all of our lives. Not just the people here tonight that want to go to law school, not just the disabled people that want to go to school, but all the people that will be impacted by the entrance and admittance to law school. I think we have to think about the fact that we need more lawyers. We need more good lawyers, kind lawyers, compassionate lawyers, empathetic lawyers, and lawyers who are willing to fight for justice. Other questions?